Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. How's your thyroid doing? If you're low on energy, gaining weight, or your metabolism is off, it's time to take a look at that little gland at the front of your neck. A century ago, severe iodine deficiency was widespread across the world, but now we have the opposite problem, with 52 nations at risk for thyroid disease due to an extreme excess of iodine. As some of you know, the health of my own thyroid was struggling in my early 20s, and hypothyroidism actually runs in my family. Now thyroid problems are rapidly increasing in frequency, but the good news is we're starting to understand why. Today, I'm thrilled to be back again with my good friend, Dr. Alan Christianson. If you're not looking closely at your thyroid health and your dietary intake of iodine specifically, this episode will show you why it's worth it. But before we get there, here's a note that just came in from Wendy. She says, Abel, you changed my life dramatically 5 years ago when you started your wild diet program. I am happy to see you back and sorry for all the challenges you've been through. I am happy to do this challenge with you and excited for the results. Your recipes in the past were amazing and I see they have been scaled back this time around. One thing I enjoyed and still enjoy is the bulletproof or fatty coffee. What happened to that? Is that still a thing? Look forward to your program. Hey, Wendy, thank you so much for the question and thank you for joining the challenge. In the past, yes, we have all sorts of different recipes. We have into the thousands of recipes, I believe, in our collection. We wanted with this new challenge to keep things very simple and straightforward and not go too far on the excess of kind of the treat foods for this challenge in particular. But one of the coolest things about our new wild challenges is we'll be having different themes for these challenges. We even had a pie baking contest during the holidays. So there will be a lot of fun to be had, as well as if you want to get super clear on getting to your goals, we can get you there too. So it's always going to be a balance. When it comes to fatty coffee, this is something I'll share with you. When I'm trying to take off a few pounds of my own frame myself, I don't put cream in my coffee or really have anything for the first half of the day. I generally fast until about noon, and I will have some black coffee. I got some right here, some black tea, something like that. But I hold off on the fat until around noon, which is, technically breaking your fast. So if you want to do strict intermittent fasting, then you really don't want to be taking in any calories or supplements while you're doing so. So for me, especially when I'm leaning down, I like to keep the fat out of my coffee for about half the day, but I do enjoy grass-fed heavy cream in my coffee. A lot of times my wife Allison will go dairy-free for extended periods of time. Sometimes I'll join her. And so coconut creamers can be great. Some of the nut-based ones, okay, but I like grass-fed heavy cream. Sometimes some coconut oil or MCT oil or other fat. But keep in mind, all you really need is about a tablespoon of fat to get you there, at least for me. If you keep adding a bunch of fat in there, you're drinking bulletproof coffees all day. You know, each one of those can be 400, 500 calories, which as much as, you know, we're not really counting calories, that definitely adds up. And I'd rather eat an entire, you know, bar of chocolate or something else highly indulgent than drinking all of that fat. So just a dab will do you. Nothing wrong with a little cream in your coffee. But if you're drinking cream in your coffee all day, be careful of that as well. And if you guys are out there, you want to join us in the next wild challenge, make sure you're signed up for our newsletter over at fatburningman.com/bonus. Or you can just go to fatburningman.com, sign up for our newsletter. And we'll tell you all about our upcoming challenges. These are more events than like one-off purchases or one-off courses or something like that you do at your own pace. This is going to be highly interactive. You know, you can interact with me. I'm going to be doing live streams, really exciting stuff. So make sure to get in on the wild challenge. All you have to do if you want to go straight there is to go to fatburningman.com/app, and that will hook you up with the wild challenge. Also, if you just want to sign up for our newsletter, we'll send you a quick little meal plan and quick start guide to get you going. But I'm really happy for all of those of you who, you know, maybe we lost touch over the years, or you followed me on the TV show or read my book many years ago. I'm happy you're back, and I'm so glad to reconnect, because we have a lot of new tools that can definitely help you out more than ever. All right, one more quick thing. If you'd like to support us, keep this free show coming to you, then make sure to check us out over at wildsuperfoods.com. This is our supplement company. My wife and I and my mom, we have great fun coming up with all sorts of different packages, deals, and discounts, hooking it into the challenges. But if you want to get started with supplementation over at Wild Superfoods, the one that I would recommend for most people, because they're deficient, is vitamin D Stack. And so vitamin D Stack has 5,000 IUs of vitamin D3 along with the cofactors. And also, if you're looking to get healthy, stay healthy during, the darker parts of the year, check out Fizzy C. This is also a stack of vitamin C with some cofactors and bioflavonoids. And it also tastes quite good. You can just add a little bit of Fizzy C to your glass of water or in your smoothie. It gives it a little fizz. It has a wonderful, refreshing flavor. You're also getting your vitamin C and the cofactors with the bioflavonoids in there. So check out Fizzy C, vitamin D stack. We also have a vitamin C stack and much, much more. Collagen, cocoa, mega omegas, probiotic spheres, and many more over at wildsuperfoods.com. So if you're in the United States, please check us out over there. I highly recommend as well checking out the subscribe and save over at Wild Superfoods, because you can save usually about 20%+, as well as you get entered into our challenges and giveaways as part of that. So check out subscribe and save. We also have 3 and 6 pack bundles if you want to really stock up and save a bunch of money at the same time. So head on over to wildsuperfoods.com. Can't wait to see you there. All right, on to this show with Dr. Alan Christianson. We're talking about hidden sources of iodine that could drive your levels dangerously high, what ideal levels of dietary iodine should look like, why eating tons of seaweed snacks is probably not a good idea, which salts could compromise thyroid health, and which choices are best, and much, much more. Let's go hang out with Dr. Christianson. Welcome back, folks. Returning to the show today is Dr. Alan Christianson, a board-certified naturopathic endocrinologist who specializes in thyroid care, and a New York Times best-selling author whose recent titles include The Thyroid Reset Diet and The Metabolism Reset Diet. Dr. Christianson has been featured on countless media, including The Dr. Oz Show, The Doctors, and The Today Show, and many more. He's also a father, an avid outdoorsman, and in fact, a surprisingly talented off-road unicyclist. Thank you so much for joining us on the show, Dr. Christianson. Such a pleasure to have you here.
Hey, Abel. Yeah, I'm happy to hang out with you, man. Always fun.
So I can personally attest to the outdoor prowess of Dr. Christianson, but I'm curious, what are you up to these days to stay active?
You know, I am still on a unicycle on occasion, doing some climbing. I mentioned my son, who's like, I'm not even in his league anymore.
Yeah.
It used to be, here, son, you can try this. Now it's, here, dad, you could try this.
I don't know. You may be too old, but try it, dad. It's funny how that happens. So, going through your most recent book, It really struck me how out of whack our intake of certain nutrients are. And many people think that they're low in something or high in something without really having any idea. So maybe we can just start by talking about the thyroid generally, why it's important and why we should care.
Yeah, it's a big deal. So it's a little thing below the skin, front of the neck, and it controls how well we burn energy, how well we repair our connective tissues, and how we send signals throughout our brain and our nerves. And it's controlled very precisely by the brain and by the other organs. But over the last several decades, the rates of its diseases have gone up like threefold. It's a huge problem nowadays.
Yeah. And people in my family have struggled with it. Other personal friends have gone through surgeries for hyperthyroid and all the rest of that. But most people think that they're low in iodine, right?
You know, not too long ago, that was a common problem. If we went back to the early 90s, we had 112 nations on the globe that were categorized as severely iodine deficient. And it was no joke. There was like probably 1 billion people born that never got proper brain development because of that. So public health, you know, wrestled itself together and did a good job, and they took care of it. And so over the course of the following 2.5 decades, there became no more nations severely iodine deficient. But now we've got 52 nations at risk for thyroid disease due to iodine excess.
So we have a massive overcorrection without necessarily realizing it.
We've got a really big overcorrection. And it's a weird story. You know, so many nutrients, nutrients are commonly used in just countless parts of the body in dozens and dozens of ways. And apart from being deficient, it's not that common that we stumble onto too much. But this whole iodine thyroid story, it's not like any other nutrients.
Yeah. So in reading through your book, the amounts that are contained in cosmetics, for example, areas that we wouldn't expect are off the charts, especially ancestrally speaking, or speaking about what our bodies are adapted to handle. Maybe you can speak to that a little bit. It seems like we're being attacked by massive amounts from all directions all of a sudden.
You know, that one especially blew me away. It was used as a hand sanitizer for quite a while, up to 2018, and the FDA banned that because so many hospital workers were getting thyroid disease from just sanitizing their hands. Well, we now know that there's a lot of other things that we put a lot of on our skin that we absorb in, like conditioners, face creams, body lotions, that have just as much iodine as hand sanitizers can have. So that's now being looked at, but to date, they've not yet been restricted.
And I remember too, when I did cross-country mountain bike racing for a couple years around high school, you know, we'd get all gashed up. For me, I remember it was always like the backs of my calves, the pedals would just like slice into them. And so then at the end of the race, just everyone, it's like someone had a paintbrush and a bucket of iodine just slathering it on everyone. And you know, we're thinking it's a pretty good plan, but not so, it sounds like.
Well, you know, and this is the thing, is that iodine is super useful. It's actually a lot like bleach. You know, it shows up on the same column of the periodic table that chlorine does. And like bleach, it does a great job at killing infections. However, we do absorb it, and we are sensitive to it in slight excesses. So yeah, there's countless ways in which it was used for like just everything in medicine in the past. And just like one by one, they're like, well, we could use this instead. That's better. So its uses keep on dwindling.
Yeah. So I was also really surprised by just the tiny amount that we actually need to do well, as opposed to some other nutrients where you can really get a blast of it and it doesn't really matter. You excrete it or something like that. That's not what you want here. But the amount that you actually need above that threshold is really minuscule.
You know, it's microscopic. And yeah, just like what you could put in a teaspoon could be your whole life supply. And there's this intuitive sense we have that if a lack of a nutrient stops something from happening, then more of the nutrient must help that thing happen better.
Right.
And I think about like keys for the car. You know, if the keys are missing, your car will not move. But if you got the keys and the car's not moving, there's some other problem. And extra keys won't make the car faster.
Yeah. Okay, so do you want like a little sprinkling every day when you're talking about iodine? Because it sounds like as well, you can't just say, oh, I'm gonna grab a thyroid support supplement, or I'm gonna get an iodine supplement, and then I'm taken care of.
You know, the body can store it pretty well, but the duration is somewhere around 6 to 8 weeks. And we mostly store that within the thyroid. So yeah, normally when we're healthy, normal thyroid function, we're all steady and even. As long as we're getting enough over the course of a couple month window of time, we'll be fine. We can level out the ups and downs.
But you don't necessarily need supplementation to get there.
We definitely do not need supplementation to get there. And that's the funny thing too, along with its useful attributes in being an antimicrobial and kind of like bleach, it oxidizes really fast. So it's hard to keep it stable in solutions. And it's in almost all multivitamins, but the amounts that are there, I mean, even the amounts that are labeled are way more than we need. But the amounts that are actually there when scientists assay the products are not what the labels say. They can be many times higher.
Right. Maybe you can dig into that a little bit more, because I think that's kind of a theme that can be generalized a bit. But people don't understand that what's listed on the label of their food and certainly their supplements is not necessarily what's even in the bottle. It could be missing entirely a fraction of the amount, or it could be many times the amount of something you don't want more of.
Well, and this is the weird thing. So we have this narrow range of tolerance, and those prone to thyroid disease, the upper limit of their tolerance is even lower. And so too little is rarely a problem. You know, we've got enough variety in our diets, and it's in almost all foods, to where too little is less of a common issue, but too much can be. And then also big erratic changes can be an issue as well. So we're thinking about it from food, like you mentioned, from supplements, from topical things, medications have that. And it's that total burden that our body deals with, that if we're outside of some target, the thyroid just can't handle that.
What does that target look like? Is it variable between individuals based on age, genetics, and all of the rest of those factors?
It is, but a safe range for the bulk of the population, adults, is about 50 to 200 micrograms per day. We've got massive data sets from populations that fortified with iodine, and we've seen exactly how different iodine intakes manifest in thyroid disease. And yeah, the World Health Organization has shown that that's the sweet spot overall. If someone has thyroid disease, they wish it to get better, they may want to be a little lower than that. But for maintaining general health, about 50 to 200 micrograms is the sweet spot for most people.
So for most of us, it sounds like we need to go through a phase of really turning down the amount in our diets and what we're exposed to from cosmetics and the rest of the sources. So what does that process look like? What sort of changes are the quick wins for people there?
Yeah, the exciting thing is that your thyroid, it gets slowed down, and it gets the immune system triggered when it gets too much iodine inside of it. And for a long time, we thought that if that horse is out of the barn, that was it.
Right.
But the exciting new angle is that, no, it can get better. And so the it getting better part, I talked about in the book, about really just avoiding the things that are big outliers. Like, just don't take supplements that have it. Look out for the creams that have it. So cut out those big things. And then the diet, I just broke down to green light, yellow light, red light.
Yeah.
So toward the goal of fixing your thyroid, just do green light foods. That easy. And once you've fixed it and it's stabilized, green light foods are all still fine, but you can also get away with one or two servings of a yellow light food per day.
What are some examples from each category? Is it predictable? I know there are some that aren't so predictable.
There's a few things that have thrown me. And the tricky thing, too, is that you'll never see iodine on a food label. And even if you do things like, there's a lot of really cool apps like Chronometer or others that will show you your micronutrient intake. They're not going to tell you iodine, you know, nor will any other online databases.
Yeah.
So I did some serious legwork and pulling government archives and whatnot. And I made a list of about 600 foods, and each one I had about 50 different samples going into it. So I did a lot of averaging and, you know, minimal, maximal, median, and mode, bust out the old statistic stuff.
Yeah.
But I crunched through that. And the cool thing is that pretty much any food category you can think of, you've got a lot of safe options, you know. But also within most categories, there are a few things that are just surprising, like a frozen cantaloupe. That's a weird one. What's this stuff called? Not dried plums. That's prune juice. Yeah. The new better term is dried plums. I don't know if you heard that or not, but the old term is prunes. So
how bizarre. Yeah.
They've rebranded, you know, because prunes sound old, but dried plums sound hip is the thought.
Yeah, I agree, for what it's worth.
But not much else for fruits and vegetables. There really aren't big issues. Grains really don't have much, grains and flours, but you go to the store and buy bread, whole different story. Mm-hmm. You know, bread, bagels, croissants, biscuits, they can have a lot. Dairy products often have quite a bit. And then salt, there's a big range from type to type.
Yeah. Maybe we can talk about bread first, because I'd love to talk about salt as well. But the breads, what is that? Is that the dough conditioners? Is it the salt, the type of salt they put in to help it, you know, in industrial situations become bread faster? What is that?
You know, I think bread is a great one to really home in on, because over this last period of time, which iodine has gone up and thyroid disease has gone up, a lot of foods that have it haven't changed that much. Bread has changed a lot. That's one of the biggest things that's shifted for people. And you asked about the dough conditioners. That is so logical. You know, there are some breads that will say made with iodized dough conditioners, and you would think that's the culprit. I've come to learn that there's a lot of things, not a big surprise, I guess, a lot of things in processed food that are not on the labels. You know, a lot of stuff goes on behind the scenes. The labels are scary enough, but there's more than what's on the labels.
Right.
So one study rounded up a whole lot of different baked products, and it put all the ones that listed anything iodized on, you know, this side of the table and all the others on that side. And then they did assays for the iodine content. They just burned it down and did HPLC studies. So the labels of iodized conditioners has no predictive value for actual iodine content.
What?
There's no, not at all.
Wow.
You can scour the ingredient list and find nothing that has that on there and still get a slice of bread that has more than 5 days worth of the safe upper limit for iodine.
Is that standard across like any packaged bread, or is it just the shelf stable ones that aren't in the freezer? Do you know, have you gotten that granular?
You know, I've seen many products assayed, and yeah, many do not have overt preservatives. Many are shelf stable. Some are even gluten-free. You can see gluten-free mm-hmm. breads that have way too much in there. And it can just vary tremendously from slice to slice and batch to batch and brand to brand.
Are there any that you feel safe enough to eat, or is it just homemade? Do you just like, how do you handle that?
You know, so a lot of this has come from empirical observation of people who have had iodine uptake scans. So before we knew that low iodine diets could help improve thyroid function, we've always known they were important before you do an iodine uptake scan or an iodine ablation procedure. You want to make your thyroid iodine hungry in those cases. And just trial and error, they've seen that, yeah, that some products are actually safe and don't throw up the scan and some are not safe. There's no commercial bread products that are consistently low.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like that's really important to know for people who are out there looking for that perfect bagel. It's going to be a lot harder to find than they might expect.
Well, you know, we have friends that have talked so much about the hidden issues of gluten, how it's not that understood.
Right.
And there's tons of people that have gone gluten-free and seem to have had their thyroid get better. And I've just like, you know, torn my hair out because I can't find any strong links between gluten and thyroid function. However, those that go gluten-free, they probably plummet their iodine intake. They're probably cutting out a whole lot of unnecessary iodine.
And when they go vegan and some other dietary totally. Choices, right?
Vegan are also autoimmune paleo. I mean, how wow. different can those things be?
Yeah.
So a lot of folks go hardcore paleo. Their thyroid seems to get better. There's studies showing that Seventh-day Adventist vegans have much lower rates of thyroid disease. They're contradictory. But if you look at the iodine content, those are all ways that you often stumble onto low iodine diets.
Yeah. I thought that was so fascinating to see that because a lot of times you do see these just wonderful results from people who are doing like what appear to be opposite diets, right?
That's always made me nuts. It was really, it made me really happy to think, oh, wow, this is a common thread.
Yeah. Okay. So the salt piece, this is a little bit confusing, right? Can you speak to the amounts of iodine in the different types of salt and then maybe speak to which salts you want to have around in your own kitchen?
For sure. So this is a really cool example of just parallel swaps. You don't have to give up salt. You know, you got great options. The amount in iodized salt is obviously significant. The highest consistent common type of salt is pink Himalayan salt as far as the iodine content. And that one surprised me too. And I wrote to several manufacturers and I said, are you guys sure about the decimals here and like where that zero goes? I mean,
right.
I've run the math how this plays out into servings and like, no, that's all correct. So that one's up there.
Yeah, that one really surprised me.
It surprised me too. You know, they're land-based, but I guess if you go back far enough, land-based salts came from the ocean far enough back, you know, and iodine comes from the ocean. So sea salts are pretty erratic. They're very different. And if you don't know the brand, it could be very high. I do like the fact that sea salts contain reasonable amounts of magnesium. So yeah, Celtic light gray sea salt. I have no financial ties. And then Malden's brand sea salts are ones that are pretty low in iodine. You know, you guys are both gourmets too. So Malden's, they make this finishing salt. It's like the coolest stuff. If you've used it before, are you familiar with it or?
Finishing salts in general, yeah. We've got a whole shelf. We love experimenting with those.
You might have this exact one already, but yeah, like little thin snowflakes, like a little bit on top and
yes.
super crunchy flavory. They've got a smoked version too, which is just incredible. And they're sea derived.
Yeah. And a lot, I think what some people don't realize is there's so much fun to be had with things, even like just salt and pepper in general. It's not the commodity that most people think it is, just the iodized salt that comes in that giant container with the umbrella and all that. You actually, like, we literally do have a shelf and we have the smoked kind, the spicy kind, and sometimes garlic or chili lime or something like that. But also when you source them from different parts of the world, or like you said, sea-based versus land-based and that sort of thing, there is a lot to explore. And even the, Like you said, those thin flakes, the floor to sell, is a wonderful experience to, you know, just like when you're eating certain foods, like a steak or an appetizer, it kind of dissolves on your tongue and there's a lot of fun to be had. So explore that, definitely. Which are the ones that you want to have in your kitchen, just to be clear for the listeners out there?
My personal favorites for cooking would be kosher salts. There's two big brands in the market. There's the Morton's brand and the Diamond brand. They're both low in iodine. The Diamond brand, a lot of chefs are quite into it because its shape itself seems to do well for sticking onto foods, dissolving really well. So that's my very favorite for cooking. And then I love the Maldon's for finishing.
Yeah, yeah. So definitely aim for two different kinds of salt, at least. Like, have a finishing salt around. It's a great thing to experiment with. It looks a little expensive at first, but you don't go through that stuff very quickly. It's you definitely taste it, and it's nice to have around. And it lasts a while, as long as you don't get it wet or something like that. What are the main foods that you just don't want to be around? One that surprised me was seaweed, dried seaweed, seaweed chips. And the implications of that are also the foods that, you know, sushi and other foods that are kind of prepared for you that you might be eating out at a restaurant, or the seaweed appetizer or the salad appetizer, whatever, might have a ton of iodine in there without you quite realizing it.
You know, the World Health Organization has shown that up to about 1,100 micrograms at a one dose is safe for most people. And yeah, you can go 10 times that on a lot of seaweed products. And again, most people can have extra iodine and do totally fine. But those susceptible to thyroid disease, they've got a different upper limit. So that's a big deal. So yeah, so sea vegetables, the whole category, you know. And at first I was pretty sad about it as far as just the things I thought you might miss out on. Then I got really deep because you hear about all the other trace minerals, all the health benefits. So I went really deep in that. And there are, you know, all other minerals there, but honestly not in that high of quantities to where they make a big difference. And then you will see a lot of stuff you wouldn't want, you know, various types of toxicants or whatnot. And they've even shown like health outcomes. So Japanese populations have the highest seaweed intakes, have the highest rates of breast cancer risk. So it's something that the more I got into, I'm like, okay, I'm okay putting that aside. You know, I had phases in my life where that was a big thing as well, but yeah, I was okay to set that one aside.
Yeah. What about electrolytes? Now you're seeing whole like product categories of salts and magnesiums and various concoctions. I'm curious, have you looked at the amount of iodine in some of those, which, you know, I guess explicit electrolyte type supplements?
You know, the odd thing, and honestly, I don't have a good answer for this one. I do see many of those products to where they have iodine as an ingredient. It's not something that really would have to show up for ways that I would know of because of the other active ingredients, but I've seen many products where they add in potassium iodide directly. Mm-hmm. And it's not categorized as an electrolyte, but yeah, it's a good thing to scan for on the ingredient list.
Yeah, because basically if you do have problems, which a lot of people do more than ever, it sounds like, with your thyroid, or you suspect you do, some of these worst offenders on your list that you include at the book are so many multiple times higher in terms of the contents, it's really worth having them on your radar and being like, oh, I'm going to try to dodge that one. So what are the main ones again? So we have sea vegetables. We have certain cosmetics. What else?
We talked about the salt. I mentioned about commercial baked goods and breads. Dairy foods have a bunch. And this one kind of makes me nuts because it really is a contaminant. You know, they use iodine pretty commonly as a teat sanitizer. There are some other products in the pipeline, and it might be the case in the coming years that's no longer an issue. But it is also fortified in a lot of cattle feed. But that's the big one. And the other one that makes me nuts is seafood. So thankfully, there are some more low iodine versions of seafood. And once one does get through the reset phase, they've got more options. But many types of seafood can add quite a bit too.
Yeah.
And then last one to be comprehensive would be egg yolks. You know, egg yolks can contain substantial amounts.
And so this could be another benefit for some people of kicking out dairy, because maybe we can explore that just a little bit more, because I also think it's a little grim and gross to even think about the reason that it's in your milk or your cheese or your cream or what have you, is because, like I said, like they painted it on the calves of the cyclists back then. They paint it on the udders and the ulcers and the whatever else is kind of down there that's not doing well. And that's why it's actually in your dairy product.
You know, thyroid disease in the modern world, it was something that was almost limited to Asia and Japan for a long time. It's not a coincidence that a doctor named Hashimoto's figured that thing out, that it wasn't like an Irish doctor. I mean, they've got lots of it. It came to the modern world around the 30s and the 40s. So in the U.S., we fortified our salt with iodine, started doing that in 1924, started that in Michigan. And the following decade, the rates of thyroid disease went up by 26 times. Now, the UK, they were about 10 years behind us, and they saw the same kind of a spike. They didn't fortify their salt. But what they did do, and we also did at the same time, we started fortifying our cattle feed and also getting uniform about iodine as a teat sanitizer. So we got it from our milk.
Isn't that interesting? But we got way too much all at once.
We got way too much. Yeah. You know, we started fortifying it because too few soldiers were eligible to join up and go fight in World War I because a lot of them had goiters.
Wow.
And many areas were low. We talk about how cool it is to have local food. That's great when you've got healthy soil. But if all you got is local food and your soil's not healthy, you're deficient. And that did happen. So they did reverse some problems, but it's sensitive. And like you said, it's been an overcorrection.
Now, speaking of overcorrection, what about low carbing at the same time? You see a lot of people, especially now, the lower carb, the better. If it's not working for you, you had to go harder and you didn't go low carb enough. But when the thyroid and metabolism is concerned and hormones in general, it's not quite so simple as that.
You know, a couple of things we know about that. So one of which is like a mechanistic model. Insulin, there are so many examples of metabolic syndrome, chronic disease that correlate with excess insulin. It's a real good marker of the body being in a state of fuel excess, but it's not the villain. You know, we need it. It's useful in a lot of ways. So when insulin levels are too low, the body assumes that we're starving. And we can have a lot of food that's not carbohydrate. We can gain weight with low insulin, but our body still thinks we're starving when that happens. And so one of the ways it tries to protect itself is it quits activating thyroid hormone. So you slow the thyroid production and you stop the thyroid conversion. You know, the biggest data set we have about extreme low carb and thyroid function comes from kids put on ketogenic diets for seizures. Kids don't get a lot of thyroid disease. You know, we could see somewhere around like 10% in a lot of adult populations. That can be like 0.1% in many pediatric populations, like, you know, 1 per 1,000. But this is so well established. You put kids on ketogenic diets and about 27% will need thyroid medication. You know, they will have their thyroid slow down that much, and many will need it after they've stopped the diet. So it can be an issue.
Yeah. So how do you correct that? With a few sweet potatoes that are strategic? Or
that can be all it takes. You know, you don't need much, but once your body thinks you're in a starvation mode, you will start to work against your own thyroid.
Mm-hmm. So where does that leave you for intermittent fasting or carb intake for the people who you work with, as well as just your own life?
You know, me personally, I do a lot of endurance athletics and I eat a lot of food in general, so not a lot of restrictions and a fair amount of carbs. But I'll hear a lot of folks that say that intermittent fasting was really helpful for them, you know, that it made a big difference for their weight or whatnot, or changing the timing of their carbohydrate. And many people can do things like that and do fine. The biggest data we have on intermittent fasting, kind of interesting, comes from Ramadan as far as thyroid function. So they look pretty closely at how thyroid function played out amongst those who follow Ramadan for a month. And those that don't have thyroid disease or those that do, their thyroid function slows by about a third in either case. And it generally does come back once they resume typical food timing again. So I don't think there's lasting harm from that. And most can fluctuate and do okay. And if it works better for them.
And that's another lesson too, where health isn't always about having the exact number at every single snapshot. Sometimes it does go in cycles. So, when you think about adaptation and the thyroid kind of down-regulating during times when you're not getting easy access to carbs or even enough food, we don't really know if that's good or if it's bad or if it's some of both, right?
Yeah. And the more resilient someone is and the more reasons that they're doing that for, that can be a totally valid choice.
But there are a lot of people, that said, who are struggling specifically with the thyroid now. What does that number look like compared to history?
In terms of frequency, well, Overall, we've got no good data going back a long ways, but last several decades, we've been tracking pretty well. And thyroid cancers between now versus the 70s, they've tripled. And it's not better detection. There's three times as much of it. Autoimmune thyroid disease, a paper from just a few weeks ago showed that it's probably at least doubled. The number of people on treatment has roughly tripled. And it seems like the big shift has been somewhere around like late 80s, early 90s. And that's like when this whole iodine thing took off like it did, when it changed globally.
And what does it look like, feel like, et cetera, for someone who does have a struggling thyroid?
You know, there's different forms of the disease, but almost all of it is hypothyroidism due to Hashimoto's. That's by far the most common. And so the thyroid controlling energy, repair, and brain function. So when it's sluggish, none of those things work well. And, you know, people, one big red flag, it's not so much a symptom you've always fought with, but it's a couple things that seem to change that are like not normal for you. You know, maybe you had a good sense of maintaining your weight with a certain amount of diet and exercise, that quit working. And that quit working 6 months ago, plain as day. That's suspicious. Same thing for brain function. Same thing for like energy levels based upon physical activity, changes in menstrual regularity, digestive issues, and then tissue repair. So that's like hair, skin, and nails, but that can also be tendonitis, recurrent injuries, chronic muscle pain. But especially when those things changed over some time frame, those were all like really big signs towards it.
Yeah. And is there an age where there's an onset of these symptoms, generally speaking? When should people really start paying attention? Is it, you know, like, does it have to be a major problem, or is there some risk of not going in early enough and having this checked out?
There's no risk to not screening if someone feels well. And yeah, I mentioned how it's quite rare in pediatrics. Each decade we live, whatever perfect storm it takes to trigger thyroid disease, you know, you've rolled the dice that many more times in the last decade, you know, so it gets more probable each decade of life. And that's true for a lot of chronic diseases. There is a gender disparity. It's about 6 to 8 times more common in women. But because it's so common overall, there's plenty of dudes that have thyroid disease. And yeah, starting around 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, by the time women reach 80, at least a quarter of them have clearly documented thyroid disease.
Wow. Wow. So if you do want to correct this course a little bit, it takes adjusting your diet and it takes a bit of time. Is there anything else that can help?
You know, in terms of the three things that we know causes it, it's age, gender, and iodine. In terms of those three, there's one we can do something about.
Yeah.
And it's crazy exciting. One of the studies that just like hit me like a ton of bricks, they took a group of people that had very severe thyroid disease. I'm not quite sure how they rounded up so many that had it so severe, but were not yet on treatment, because that's not common.
Right.
But that's who they were. And they'd had it for at least 4 years. And they did also show that their levels were stable. It wasn't like they were up and down and maybe about to hit a good patch. They've been pretty steady for a while. And they did nothing but have them regulate their iodine for 3 months. And within those 3 months, 78.3% of them had perfectly normal thyroid function again. Like just fine. Wow. Like it wasn't even an issue. And wait, there's more. So of those who didn't get better, there was three different groups, you know, this remaining, whatever we got, 28 some odd percent. Of the three groups, there was those to whom they did everything perfectly, but their levels didn't budge at all. That was about 2%. The other big groups were those to where they didn't do things perfectly. You know, maybe the instructions weren't that great. Maybe they didn't take it seriously. But when their iodine levels were measured, they were still getting rid of a lot. There was still a bunch coming in, and they didn't get better. The other group, they were off by such a huge amount that they were improving. Like their TSH scores, we like to see, you know, higher is lower. The higher it is, the more underactive your thyroid is. It's considered abnormal above 4.5, probably healthiest around 2. Well, a lot of these folks were at like 50 to 200. So they were off by a lot. And in those 3 months, they came down by like 50 or 75%, but they weren't normal. So they didn't get into that 78.3%, but they were sure heading that way. So yeah, of those who did it and it just didn't help at all, that was only a few percent.
Mm-hmm. And then if you are on prescription medication for your thyroid, thyroid, excuse me, which a lot of people are, especially these days, it turns out diet does matter, right? You do have to continuously make adjustments and accommodations and make sure that you're not combining some of these drugs with the wrong foods, right?
You know, for sure. And even those that don't even have a thyroid, they know they'll be on medications long term. So there's two big parts to how thyroid hormones work in your body. One of which is, are they there? Do you have enough? You know, are they even there to begin with? And so those who aren't making it enough by themselves, that's the role the medication plays. But the other part of the equation is how your body responds to those hormones. You know, how well your liver takes it in, how well your mitochondria can utilize the hormones. And these are things that can fluctuate based on your iodine status. So even if you've got no thyroid and you're theoretically taking exactly what you need, a lot of people in that scenario are not feeling their best just yet because their body is blocking and fighting thyroid hormones due to too much iodine.
Let's also talk about bacon and processed meats. Because this is an important point. A lot of people, especially if they hop on the low carb or the keto train or what have you, you know, the more bacon, the better. It doesn't really matter if it's processed meat. But specifically speaking about the thyroid and hormones in general, it does matter. And it could be a giant source for some people that they don't really realize, especially if you have, you know, I think bacon is best used, generally speaking, as a topping, as are any of those semi-processed meats or the rest of that. But a lot of people, too many, are using that as actually a protein source, right? Like, or a source of calories.
You know, there's some part of our diet which might be like, based on how healthy we are, it might be like 10% or 3%, to where you could put anything in there and it probably won't matter. It really probably won't matter. But you're right. So processed meats can be high in iodine. There was a pretty fascinating study I found. I've tried so hard to find all the studies on diet and thyroid disease. And once you put aside the 22,000 studies on iodine, you've got, no joke, like a dozen studies left.
Wow.
And most of them don't have even much to say.
Yeah.
So one of these in this dozen was called the 10,001 Dalmatian study. So this is not dogs. Cruella de Vil is not involved, but there are ethnic Dalmatians in Croatia. I had no idea. And they are somewhat prone to thyroid disease. So this study mapped out 19 different food categories, and it looked at, with variable consumption of the various food categories, how did that play into autoimmune thyroid disease? So one of the food categories that had the most predictive effect of those developing autoimmune thyroid disease was the highly cured and processed meats. So people knew that was a big part of their diet. This study also showed that that food category could be an issue.
So that probably is even more true for the people who are trying to get the, like a source of salmon, for example, from lox or from these salted meats. Maybe not the best plan if you're eating too much of it anyway.
You know what? And that's the one that just breaks my heart, because there's so much benefit to seafood. So I was happy to see that there are some safer options. You know, freshwater fish is really good. There's some cool freebies like squid, believe it or not, or scallops.
Oh, for whatever reason, I love scallops.
Don't accumulate it. Have you ever done squid steaks?
Yes. Not in a while, though. Not out here in Colorado.
That was a new one on me. You know, the big steaks of them, and they're not that hard to find in the grocery stores. They're cost effective. They're really good when you cook them well.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. So whenever you're, you know, being forced to cut things out for your own health, keep in mind, everyone, you can have a lot of fun with this. There's a lot more to explore. Let's see. So what does a day of eating look like in kind of a nightmare scenario that people don't realize is a nightmare in terms of iodine content?
Boy, you know, standard American diet.
Yeah.
So yeah, you have like some milk, some eggs, some processed grains to start your day. You pop a multivitamin, you get a fast food meal, you know, you have whatever in the evening, you got high dye salt, and you know, you could eat typical foods and walk away with anywhere from like 500 to 2000 micrograms of iodine. And again, that 200 was your upper limit.
And then what does a good day repeated over time look like in terms of lower iodine content?
That's the cool thing. You've got so many options. If you're already committed to ancestral type diet or a plant-based diet, you know, gluten-free, you don't have to change a darn thing. It's super easy. But yeah, you can do I do a fair amount of high quality animal protein. I do a lot of vegetables, lots of intact whole grains. And those things are all fine with that. Fruits and vegetables, with very few exceptions, you've got good options that way. So you can bake things at home if you like to. Nuts and seeds, legumes are all fair game. So there's very few things you have to work around.
What about condiments? You know, ketchup, mustard, fermented veggies, that sort of thing.
So this is kind of cool. And there's what they might have based on their ingredients. In almost all cases, processed foods don't use iodized salts. So that's helpful. The weird exception is Burger King. For whatever reason, they use iodized salt.
Okay.
Figure. Well, and then fermented foods, we used to think that iodine in salt would inhibit the fermentation process. Large studies have shown that's not true. But still, there is pickling and canning salt that's iodine-free. So those things are rarely a problem. The one exception there is there are some exotic versions of kimchi that use a lot of anchovies or fish extracts where that can add up. But in almost all cases, all those things you mentioned are just not a concern.
Yeah. Awesome. We have a few minutes left, but I want to make sure we also talk about how do you raise capable kids in a time like this, because I hung out with your son, went on a hike, and he's just, you know, jumping circles around all of us, even when he was much younger than he is now. So how do you, I know a lot of parents are kind of struggling with the opposite problem, right? Where kids, they can't get them away from the video games or out of the house or whatever. So how did you help really foster an environment where your kids could get out of the house and feel really comfortable with that?
You know, looking back, I wish this was more deliberate than it was, but I don't know. I have myself had a lot of passions, a lot of things I enjoyed, and I just kept exposing him to stuff, and I kept just bringing him with, and over time, there was many things I was into that weren't a big deal for him, and honestly, I let them go from my life as well. I've realized that I've got a very finite amount of time for recreation, and I want that stuff that he and I can both enjoy doing. So of the things that he really lit up for and grabbed onto, I've just encouraged in him. And I've kept up myself, even if there are things that I might not be as into anymore myself, I've just maintained that so he and I can have that. So that's been important, is just finding some shared passions and cultivating shared passions. And, you know, I think about, like, not that long ago, he and I were sitting below Glacier Point in Yosemite and, you know, watching the waterfalls, watching the sunset. And the kind of conversations you can have then, you can't force. You know, there's no way in the world you can fabricate a level of connection like you can have when you're in the midst of something that you means that much to both of you.
I would imagine it probably helps, too, that you've literally held each other's lives in your hands, right? Doing rock climbing and things like that. You've held mine, for example. But I think there is an extra level of trust there that probably wasn't so unusual looking back into the past, but kind of is unusual now. So there's some benefit to really doing these types of adventures where you're out there in the elements together can really bond you together in a good way, don't you think?
I do. And in terms of also just like responsibility, you know, it's, I think about where I was in my life as a teenager, a young teenage boy, and I see him, and so often we'll be outdoors and, you know, I'll step back and let him make the calls as far as, you know, which way we're going, if we proceed or not, if we're going to retreat from this one or something. And he makes really good calls. He's got good judgment. And there's a lot of times I'm thinking, oh, we'd be okay. He's like, no, I don't feel good about this. I'm like, cool, we're not going to go this way. And so, yeah, I'm really happy that he's developing some maturity that I think is better than I had when I was his age.
Well, right on. Did we miss anything? For the people who are listening out there who want to make sure that this doesn't go unnoticed, that the iodine intake, making sure they have enough but not too much, did we miss anything here, or what are some takeaway points?
You know, I think the big takeaway is just that thyroid disease can get better. And, you know, like when you and I talked in the past years, I didn't know it that it could change as much as I know now, you know, and I've seen this firsthand and I'm so, so happy about it. I've always felt that with treatment, people could feel better. But as far as the function coming back again, this is new stuff for me, 25 years of doing this stuff. And this is new for me. And I'm just totally jazzed about that. So yeah, you've got more hope than you ever realized before.
That's awesome. All right, Doc. So what's the best place to find your work, and what are you working on next?
DrChristianson.com, just the main website, DrChristianson.com. And yeah, I'm playing around with a couple of ideas. I'll probably be doing a cookbook for the follow-up book to this. But yeah, that'll be a fun thing. I I love cooking. You guys are awesome at that, but I want to get a lot of just good recipes together for follow-up for all these other books. But the other thing I'm thinking about a lot is, so like archery, if you always hit left, you compensate, right? Like, oh, I got to aim farther than I think I've got to aim to the right, and you come out okay. So there's a whole lot of ways in which our minds, they work fine. You put your hand on the hot stove, you can trust that. Like, okay, that's good, you know? But our appetite, our response to information, you know, how we perceive data sets, you know, how we respond to our emotions. There's a whole lot of things where we're predictably off, you know, where we need to calibrate. We've got to lean. Like in aviation, you've got a thing called trim, where if a plane was bent and it goes this way, you bend the rudder and now you're going to do okay. There's some things we've got to do like that for our minds in these different domains. So that's what I'm, polarized topics, how we address those. There's certain ways we've got to trim. We've got to compensate. And that's the one afterward. And I'm sorting that one out.
I like that. I can't wait to get into that one.
Very cool. Yeah, the things that work okay, we can ignore. There are automatic responses that are good.
Right.
Let them happen.
Right.
But some of them, the automatic responses are not good. We should know that. We should make educated adjustments.
Yeah, I'm totally with you. It reminds me of, I studied for a couple of years in Austin, Krav Maga, which was a type of self-defense and martial arts where you're trying to harness that primitive, just natural flinch that you have into an actual useful movement. So I think that's such an interesting concept, right? Where you're not trying to just program something completely new, you know, just shatter whatever your instinct is down to zero and then through training build something else. No, you harness what's already there and try to get rid of the frivolous or not useful instincts as well, which are definitely also there. Well, Dr. Christianson, thank you so much for coming on the show. We really appreciate your work. We need it more than ever.
Oh, thanks for having me. Always fun to hang out in any format.
Hey, folks, this is Abel James, and I'm extremely excited to be here today with one of our favorite supplements of all time, Fizzy C. It's buffered vitamin C with citrus bioflavonoids in the form of a tasty little powder. Now, the trick with this is just start with a little bit at a time. As opposed to some other vitamin C's that taste horrible, really sour, and hard to get down, this actually is pretty easy to get down too much. And so if you have too much vitamin C, you know what happens. So the point is, you want to take a small amount. It's easy to overdo it with these. So just a teaspoon or less is good to get started. But what Fizzy C is a high quality source of vitamin C in the form of ascorbic acid, calcium ascorbate, magnesium ascorbate as well. And then there's potassium bicarbonate that's added as well as a buffering agent. And this makes it a little bit easier to get down. And I find this to be pretty much the tastiest form of vitamin C out there. So if you're interested in Fizzy C and you have any questions, please get in touch. We can't wait to see how you like our brand new Fizzy C. Get in touch and let us know. This is Abel signing off. We'll talk to you soon. Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon, and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening, and have a great week.